As the Harry Potter series went on, the books got longer and longer. With the first three, the increase in the number of pages was gradual and not too noticeable. Then Goblet of Fire came out and it was twice the size. When I first saw it, I thought it was a practical joke. It looked like an encyclopedia. The hardcover is a whopping 734 pages. What children's book do you know of that's 700 pages? But that was part of J.K. Rowling's spell. She entranced us with her first three and then hit us with this brick. She knew we would flock to the bookstores no matter how long it was. To this day, my opinion remains unchanged. Goblet of Fire is my favorite book in the series. Even though it seems relatively complex in comparison to the others, yes, even more so than Prisoner of Azkaban, it takes the world of Harry Potter and brings it to its knees. It's a non-stop thrill ride of excitement, genuine danger, meaty character development, likable side stories, and the return, or should I say, the introduction, of a very promising villain. It took the best elements of all the books before it and combined them into a super novel. It had the charm and the danger of the first, the mystery and puzzle solving of the second, and that looming presence of darkness of the third. Basically, it was everything a Harry Potter fan could ask for. To my recollection, this was the book that kind of broke Harry Potter into the mainstream. When I first started reading them, there was just the first three, and while there was sort of this buzz that was circulating about them, they were still just fun little children's stories, and you could find them anywhere. Hell, I got my copies at Costco. And this was the last book in the series to come out before Warner Brothers started making the films, the real reason Harry broke out into the mainstream. But the sheer size of this book garnered some attention because, again, it was being hailed as a children's book. Kids who didn't normally read outside of school were now buying up Harry Potter books like they were cocaine. The first three books seemed like decent sizes to make into movies. Sure, here and there they had to do some trimming, but it wasn't all that noticeable. But because of Goblet of Fire's length, the studio was wondering if they could legitimately adapt it into a single film, or if they should cut it into two, similar to how Tarantino handled his Kill Bill films. Today, we see this a lot more, even when it doesn't call for it. Hobbit. Every Harry Potter book since Goblet was around the same length, so can you imagine if every one of the movies would have been cut into two parts? You'd have 11 films. Eventually, it was announced that Goblet of Fire would be released as one movie, which was okay from a series standpoint, but that meant that the story would have to be seriously truncated, and the first things to go were those meaty side stories that, while not entirely integral to the plot, served to season an already great narrative. A big section of the Quidditch World Cup was simply slashed, as was all the stuff regarding Hermione and their House Elf Liberation Front. There's also some cool stuff that got left out regarding Rita Skeeter at the Yule Ball. Now, did any of these subtractions take away from my viewing experience? Not at all. If anything, for a fantasy film like this, I think those things were better left out. This one, more than any of the others, focuses on the fantasy elements. I'm a sucker for dragons. This movie has them. A lot of supporting characters that had small cameos in the past films finally get their moments to shine. The darkness of the film is evenly balanced with humor. We even get a little bit of that good old high school melodrama between Ron and Hermione.
You're fraternizing with the enemy.
Next time there's a ball, pluck up the courage and ask me before somebody else does. And not as a last resort.
Considering the book that it's based on, it's a really meaty movie. So while the book starts us off once again with the Dursleys, the movie this time bypasses them and sends us right to the Quidditch World Cup, where we get a very small glimpse of how the sport of Quidditch is played professionally.
How far up are we?
Well, put it this way. If it rains, you'll be the first to know.
At least in the book. In the movie, a small downer is that they don't actually show any of the action. They introduce a key character, Quidditch hero Victor Krum, and then cut to the aftermath. Within seconds, the crowd is in panic when Lord Voldemort's Dark Mark is seen floating in the sky and his loyal followers, the Death Eaters, show up to attack everyone. At school, Dumbledore introduces the cancellation of the year's Quidditch matches, sad face, in order to make room for the Tri-Wizard Tournament, an excessively dangerous tournament that pits advanced wizards against several life-threatening perils. We're introduced to Mad-Eye Moody, played by Brendan Gleeson, who has got to be one of my favorite performances in the whole series. They designed him perfectly to coincide with his character in the book, and his cynical, sly delivery fits the bill flawlessly.
And your new defense against the dark arts, teacher. I am here because Dumbledore asked me. End of story. Goodbye, the end.
All throughout the film, he's just a pleasure to watch. There's a scene where Draco Malfoy attempts to curse Harry behind his back, and Mad-Eye, again, much to the applause of fans, turns Draco into a ferret as punishment.
Is that a student?
Technically, it's a ferret.
There's also a particularly nasty scene where he demonstrates the three forbidden curses in front of a classroom, using a spider as his visual aid. Mad-Eye is probably the most interesting character in the series, if not the most fun to watch. He's one of those unpredictable characters whom you wish just had more screen time, just to see what he's going to do next. So the way the tournament works, Wizards of Age place their names into the Goblet of Fire, as the title suggests. Supposedly, the cup is protected by all kinds of spells, so when George and Fred Weasley use an aging spell to try and trick the goblet, of course it backfires on them. When it comes time for the selection of the three champions, Harry's name is summoned, making it the Quad Wizard Tournament. This is where Gambin really shines as Dumbledore.
Harry Potter! No. No. Harry Potter!
From this point on, Harry has to undergo scrutiny from the staff and his classmates because they think he cheated in an attempt to become more popular. Even Ron doesn't believe that he had nothing to do with it, and his jealousy leads to conflict between the two for the first time.
I don't want eternal glory. I just want to be piss off.
Fearing for Harry's safety, Hagrid sneaks Harry onto the castle grounds to reveal what the first task entails, fighting dragons. So the main plot involves the three tasks of the Triwizard Tournament, and these are like the main events of the film. First, Harry has to retrieve an egg from a dragon called a Hungarian Horntail. This happens to be my favorite scene of the film. I love dragons. Then he has to rescue Ron from the depths of the lake while fighting off a horde of evil merpeople. Supposedly, this underwater sequence was the most expensive scene to shoot.
Oh my god! I've killed Harry Potter!
And finally, the contestants have to fight their ways through a giant maze, employing all kinds of spells to survive until the victor finds the Triwizard Cup at the end. After completing each task, Harry and the others get a clue that helps prepare for the next challenge. Because of Harry's inexperience, he also gets help from Cedric Diggory, Mourning Myrtle, Neville Longbottom, and even Mad-Eye. So the big moment comes when Harry and Cedric, both representing Hogwarts, find the cup and decide to win the tournament together. They dash for the cup when suddenly they're both transported to a graveyard. Cedric is rendered, dead, and Harry is tied up by Peter Pettigrew. He cuts Harry, then cuts off his own hand. Did I mention this movie was rated PG-13? And apparently, when you mix that together, you get Lord Voldemort in a can. Voldemort's played by Ralph Fiennes, and for the little screen time he has, he does a great job of basically just being mean to Harry. He tortures him a little bit, then challenges him to a duel. This seems like the most cowardly thing he could do. Obviously, Harry's completely outmatched. And why does he want to kill a kid for?
I'm going to kill you, Harry Potter.
Couldn't he wait until he at least graduates? A lot of fans have problems with the makeup. Whether you liked his overall design or not, it's pretty much the way Rowling described him. He's essentially half man and half snake. If you look at his brief appearance at the end of Sorcerer's Stone, there's quite a resemblance, even though at that time he was being played by someone else. I think his effectiveness and his overall cruelty stems from the performance more than the look of the character, but I have to say, I'm for it. So anyway, they lash out with their wands when for no reason a stream of light surrounds the both of them. Harry sees his parents, as well as Cedric's spirit, who tells him to take his body back to his father. Harry barely escapes with the knowledge that Voldemort has returned. But ultimately, it's my favorite book, as well as my favorite film in the series. I'm not sure if a non-reader would completely get all of the little character arcs, and this one more than any of the others sometimes feels a bit rushed, so it's hard to look at it from anything but a fan's perspective. It's hard to recommend just one movie to a newbie, because ultimately you should watch all the earlier ones to understand the later ones. The movies, almost more so than the books, were designed that way. That was the continuing problem with the movies as they went on. The filmmakers had to keep finding ways to explain things that had been completely left out or trimmed in films prior, but had already been established long before in written form. Regardless, they did what they set out to do. They took a hell of a long book and made it into a wonderfully enjoyable fantasy film.
Everything's going to change now, isn't it?
Yes.